In the case of the Yom Kippur War, there was no consensus from the outset, and the controversies began in the midst of the fighting. One abortive attempt to shape such an authoritative version was articulated in the terms of reference for the Agranat Commission of Inquiry after the war. The commission was established by a reluctant government under heavy public and political pressure. Yigal Shefi, who sits with us here, raised an issue which I still have to examine, that during the government discussions of the terms of references, there were two drafts. One spoke about examining the acts of both the political and military echelons, and the second avoided both of these terms and spoke about what should be probed or investigated and not who should be investigated. The terms of reference of the commission included three clauses that were defined by the government and instructed the commission to probe into what could not be concealed in any case. The first clause said to find out the information that had been at the disposal of the Israeli intelligence community before the war and which operational steps were taken on the basis of that information. Well, every Israeli heard the alarm that was sounded on 6th October 1973 at 2 p.m. It was impossible to conceal the surprise, so it should have been investigated. The second clause said that, or told the commission to investigate the battles fought during the checking of the invasion or the first phase of the war. Again, under the circumstances of overwhelming surprise at the beginning of the war, failures and difficulties in the early days of the fighting were unavoidable, admitted, and should have been examined critically. Well, everyone saw the pictures of the prisoners of war, the Israeli prisoners of war on TV. Everyone saw the pictures that the Egyptians took on the Mauzim, on the stronghold along the Suez Canal. It couldn't be conceived. And the third clause said to probe into the IDF's general preparedness for war. This vague and all-inclusive formula meant to check the IDF emergency stores, where the war material of the reserve units had been maintained. Hundreds of thousands of reservists complained on lacking or deficient equipment, and it was no secret. The inquiry into these matters should have calmed down the excited reservists. This threefold formula implied that all the rest did not need or was not worthy of inquiry. The IDF recovered from the initial shock, regained the initiative, reoccupied some of the lost terrain, captured new territories, encircled the Egyptian Third Army, arrived 100 kilometers from Cairo and 30 plus kilometers from the outskirts of Damascus, and achieved Israel's greatest military victory. This should have been the official narrative of the war, but it fell apart before it had any chance of being accepted. All the rest, as I called it, deserved investigation, not less than the issues that the commission was authorized to probe. Some of the most scandalous campaigns took place a week or two after the beginning of the war. The same inadequacies and follies that characterized the IDF at the beginning of the war repeated themselves in the following days, until the ceasefire and even beyond. It would be enough to mention a few, the Chinese farm or the crossing campaign, the occupation of Mount Hermon, the abortive adventure in the city of Suez, and even the offensive in Syria, at least in its southern edge. Thus, the Israeli public was torn from the beginning between the glorification of the war as an unprecedented, though bloody, victory, and the frustration of those who returned from the battlefields. This dichotomy persists to the present. One way of living with it was to differentiate between the good, the military that brought the achievements, and the evil politicians that were responsible for the circumstances under which the war began. Or to put it in a personal and more perceptible language, between Chief of Staff Dado, or David Elazar, and the Minister of Defense Dayan. Another way of living with it was to blame the intelligence community, particularly Amman, the military intelligence, and to be more specific, its chief, Zaira, and his aide for analysis, Shalev, who deserved much of the blame, but certainly not exclusively.